Unga bunga? Unga bunga.
This video is all about hedging your bets. One option to beat many, many to beat one, and why that's important to refining your play in Guilty Gear and all fighting games. Please watch. Concept: hedging your bets, also known as the twofer. Imagine you're playing against Soul Bad Guy, and in a given moment, he's been mixing it up between air dash and running in. While we can challenge forward movement with a preemptive far S, it loses to a preemptive air dash. If we wait to challenge the air dash on reaction, we risk letting Soul run in uncontested. If you're familiar with Faust's toolset, we know that 2P acts as a check against forward movement while leaving us available to anti-air. So this is what I'm talking about when I refer to hedging your bets, or the twofer, or two for one, or whatever you want to call it. It's a way to use one option against the spread, one option of yours to beat two of their own, sometimes one option of yours to beat three of their own. We know swinging far as randomly in neutral can be pretty good, but how do we turn that into a game plan that involves the opponent that we can refine and, at the end of the day, digest? Step 1. Compare a spread of options versus one of your own. Example: far S versus everything? First, accommodate for reactions. Because far S has 12 frames of startup, it can't be blocked on reaction. Like 2H, it needs to be blocked or dealt with on a read, or completely outspaced. If they can't outspace it, but want to deal with the far S, what can they do? What options are relevant? What's likely to work? What can work, but isn't worth it? Identifying the spread of relevant options from your opponent requires an understanding of reactions, risk versus reward, and you need to know that your opponents may differ in terms of reaction, skill, and knowledge. As you play Guilty Gear and focus on these subjects, the options will become clearer and clearer. You can even ask other players for help, find advice via Discord, or even other YouTube videos. Well, I'm not about to leave you hanging on this subject, so let's roleplay, alright? Crack, in the Soul matchup, what does your far S lose to? Well, I'll tell you. Preemptive air dash. Air dashing over is a very rewarding option. Far S has a lot of recovery, so if it was going to work on anything, it would be against Far S. If I was thinking about Far S, they could jump like 17 to 20 frames before I hit the S button, and I still wouldn't be able to stop myself. I need time to react. Moves that go under or over the Far S hitbox immediately. Both Bandit Bringer and Night Raid Vortex are similar in that respect, with NRV going under Far S immediately, making for an even more generous timing window. Moves that have crushing properties, which is to say moves like 6P with its upper body invuln, are far more likely to win an exchange like this. Aside, make sure you check how likely something is to work. While it is possible to beat 6P startup with Far S, ask yourself how big that window really is. You can lab it out, or even check Dust Loot. In this case, 6P is objectively strong, given that you'd have to clip a 2-frame window for Far S to win. Swinging too late and Soul gets too deep. While you can check movement with Far S, if they get too close and manage to block, Faust puts himself in a perilous situation. Soul shimmying at supermax range. If they have the time to get out of range, they might play reactively, aiming to net themselves a reaction punish that they don't need to commit for. Okay, we made it, let's recap. We chose preemptive Far S to start this experiment. Far S loses to the following options: preemptive air dash, preemptive bandit bringer, preemptive night raid vortex, preemptive 6P, dash blocking early enough, and playing reactively at a distance to net a whiff punish. When you're doing this, it's okay to write this shit down. Step 2. A few options of yours versus the spread. So this is where you're really working your brain. Browse through your options aside from Far S in that same situation and ask yourself if they do any better. Preemptive options are just that, preemptive. They come out on a read, whether or not you actually Far S. Even at a glance, I'm sure most of you out there in Guilty Gear land can tell that most of these options are actually punishable on reaction if you're just walking backwards. All these whiff punishable normals, risky air movement, things that are punishable on block, movement, for the most part, seems like a great low commit option. However, it's not that straightforward. Play too reactively and you aren't covering all the options, or taking full advantage of your opponent's habits. Regardless, this brings us to our first takeaway. If Far S is working, I should move more, unless they also like to do things that beat movement. So let's keep going, what's the next option? Well, throwing 2P is another good option. It checks against forward movement like Far S, but doesn't lose to 6P even on whiff. With its lightning-fast recovery, it does really well against air dash as well. Even with meter, it denies Soul's attempts to bully his way in with Night Raid RC, which backwalking doesn't do. And what about low dive kick? 2P doesn't do a lot of damage, whereas dive kick does fairly well against Soul forward movement and gives you a big reward on counter hit. So how do you choose which option to use? Capitalizing on player fear. Choose two options your opponent might be scared of in the given moment. It can be as simple as you've been doing a lot of backwalk and it's been working, and you've had a lot of successful preemptive far slashes. A smart opponent is going to try their best to hedge their bets accordingly. Do this whole experiment enough, and you'll understand what their next plan of action could look like, and adjustment will be much simpler to figure out ahead of time. In this example, lots of footsies involving backwalk and far S can make dive kick more likely to work as Soul starts to use more movement. But it also could encourage a Bandit Bringer from Soul, depending on the player. We touched on that earlier. Bandit Bringer is hard to react to and safe on block. Walking backwards doesn't really challenge it, and Far S loses outright. Even if 2P doesn't die outright, it certainly doesn't do much. Dive Kick doesn't seem to do much against it either. It's more likely to trade than anything else. So let's make another simple takeaway after all those big thinkums. An opponent scared of any of those isn't likely going to be running deep enough or far enough to make you regret a jump back jump H. You could take a pot shot at Bandit Bringer without fear of reprisal. A sudden backdash would work well to upset his bringer spacing, and he would really need to chase after you to make you regret it, something he's not doing if you're swinging far S or 2P. This video is not Cracked's guide to Faust far S and the Soul matchup. It's a video about process. Step 1. Pick a single option in a common situation. In this case, it was far S at max range. Step 2. Lab all the relevant countermeasures your opponent can present. Seems straightforward if you have a decent understanding of Guilty Gear. Step 3. Using as few options as possible, try to answer the spread as best as you can. Build an understanding for your opponent's options and how best to hedge against them. Step 4. Make small, tiny takeaways that you can then go and apply in a real match, right? In this case, Far S makes my 2P and dive kick better. If they are really tired of Far S, 2P and dive kick, jump back, jump H. Probably a strong option, at least in the Soul matchup. And step 5, do this a bunch. This whole process, every situation, every new option you run into, any situation you find you could develop further. It's about refinement. It's not about being right or wrong. It's about making a better game plan and a more complete game plan than you did previously. That's all there is to Guilty Gear. Refining your play. That's all there is to fighting games. Really. Well, thanks for watching.